An absolutely tremendous result, the second win for Cofidis and the second win in the history of the Tour for Jean Izaguirre. Huge moment.
Welcome back to Tour de France Beyond the Podium. I'm Sam Bewley here with Brent Bookwalter. We've just finished watching stage 12, and I'll tell you what, that was one stage that you wanted to tune into from kilometre zero.
Ooh, yeah.
Not a lot of people have the luxury of watching a Tour de France stage from the start to the finish, but man, that was one that you should have seen from the start.
It's a good point. It wasn't too long ago where most of that we would have missed. The coverage used to start an hour or two from the finish. We would have missed all that action, and there was heat being thrown from kilometre zero for hours.
And it just kept everyone guessing which was the most exciting part of it. Like we got up there a couple of times during the live show to talk about, you know, what's happening, what are we seeing, what are the tactics at play. And I had to just keep watching the race to try to work it out, because we expected a big fight for the breakaway, of course, on a stage like that. We spoke about it before the start. Uphill, a lot of climbs at the start, a couple of category three climbs inside the first 35, 36K. So it was always going to be a big fight for the breakaway, and not to mention the fact that breakaway had a very realistic chance of succeeding. So if everybody wants to be in there, but it just got so out of control. Even Jumbo was starting to, Wout van Aert was attacking, so that's what we expected to see, because he's trying to win a stage here. Although he's been working like the domestique he is, world's best domestique that he is, for Jonas Vingegaard. He wants to win a stage. We know that. We've been talking about that. You love talking about Wout van Aert. And
not anymore. He lost me today.
But when Tiesch Benoot started going in breakaways, Wilco Kelderman started going in breakaways, then I started to think, like, what's Jumbo's play here? Are they trying to set something up for later in the stage on those three climbs at the end? It just had me guessing the whole time, and it was just such an exciting race to watch. And we said it before the start, stage 10 was made of nightmares. This one was worth, they'll sleep with the lights on tonight, the riders.
Yeah, there were some guys that were hurting out there today and also paying the price. We saw those guys that were attacking at kilometer zero. It wasn't long and they're just like out of the equation. The best guys in the race, the best climbers, many of the guys we saw eventually getting in the break, they were consistently up there moving around, showing that they had really good form and good legs. But I mean, there weren't many guys out there today who weren't suffering. You know, you see the best guys, Pogacar and Vingegaard, following the wheels quite easily. They almost always had teammates around them. We didn't see any real isolation today. I know there was a moment where we were scratching our heads, like UAE with Adam. This is a good moment. Put some pressure on him now.
You say that, like, not really. The leaders weren't really isolated, but I would say that Vingegaard to some degree was as isolated as you'll ever get him. He had at one point only four teammates there with him, and
that's not isolated.
But it is in the team in terms of Jumbo Visma, who is such a strong team. They're so dominant in a lot
that's
of ways.
True.
And when Tiesch Benoot was in a breakaway, eventually after about 2 hours of racing, a group went up the road. Tiesch Benoot initially was with just two other riders, and then Vingegaard only had three other guys with him. And he was, at that point, I would say that's isolation. And the way that the race was so out of control, Adam Yates was there. He's sitting there in four and a half minutes on GC, and the race was still kicking off behind. Even though Tiesch Benoot was up the road, it was still kicking off behind. It was a perfect opportunity for Adam Yates to not go berserk and not start throwing haymakers and trying to knock out everybody in the first
test
round.
Him.
But just test them and follow the right groups. And all he had to do was just, every time someone attacked, just follow it. Just tag it, and Vingegaard would then have to close it. Tag another group, Vingegaard has to close it. Eventually, maybe Adam Yates slips away into a group. All of a sudden, it's got 30 seconds, 40 seconds. Vingegaard's going, I've only got a couple of teammates here with me. Then they're under the pump. It's the reverse of what Jumbo did to UAE last year. And it was a stage that you wouldn't expect it to happen, but you've got to look for those opportunities in this situation.
On the other hand, I think it says something to UAE's confidence, which is maybe not traditionally we see them throwing the long bomb, the heavy moves early. But I think if they are waiting and not utilizing today this lumpy, hilly, medium mountain stage as an opportunity, I think they're really confident that Pogacar is going to be really good in the Alps. Mm. And they're not feeling like they need to buffer any more lead or take any more advantage over him.
And maybe it sounds hypocritical of me, because I've been saying UAE need to race a little bit differently to what they did last year, where they were more aggressive, you know, wanting to take risks and race every single day, or at least Pogacar was. And I said, oh, maybe they need to be a bit more patient. They need to be a little bit more practical about what they're doing.
They're doing it.
But cycling 101, at least from a strategic side of things, is that if the leader's team is under pressure, you squeeze. you squeeze it even tighter. And they have a guy who, there who's sitting at 4.5 minutes on GC. He just needs to go up the road. Well, it's not easy for him to go up the road, but just to keep, like, just to follow every now and again. And
just because they didn't use him today doesn't mean we won't see him use him.
They will use
them. Days.
I know that, but that's not what I'm saying.
Yeah,
what,
but what I'm you're saying talking is, as a director in that with that controller in the Corrigan, man.
That's the beauty of being a sports director. You get to play PlayStation. We were both victims of being computer gamed by our sports directors. Now it's my turn.
Shut up.
But no, what I'm saying is that, like, they will use Adam Yates, and they have been using him with success throughout this race. But at that point, it was the most vulnerable Jumbo-Visma have been.
Which is still not very vulnerable.
Which is still not very vulnerable, but you've got to take the little chances. And probably nothing would have happened, and maybe they would have closed it down and Adam Yates wouldn't have got away in a breakaway. But there was an opportunity there, I think, for at least a small part of the race to apply a little bit of pressure to Jumbo.
Yeah.
Just to put them a little bit on the back foot.
I think UAE will be quite happy looking back on the stage that Jumbo-Visma invested the resources of Thijs Benoot being in that breakaway. He'd burned some legs today. That was a big effort being out there. He was fighting hard for the stage win at the end, and they didn't get it. They still want that stage win. They don't have one yet. UAE's sitting back, well, we got two, and none of our guys did an effort like that today. I think that in itself is a positive day for UAE.
And it was almost, you make a really good point there, and it's almost like Jumbo were racing with a bit of desperation because they haven't got that stage win yet.
Yeah.
And I think that desperation, for a small period of today's race, open them up to a bit of vulnerability.
Maybe, yeah.
And UAE obviously have a plan, and that their plan is to be patient and wait for the days to come. There could have been an opportunity there. I don't know. We will never know. But I feel like there was a little bit of vulnerability there from Jumbo when they were trying so hard to get in the breakaway, and they want to win a stage clearly. So there was a chance, I think.
Yeah. Time will tell. Can we look back at today and see a bit of what happened?
This is when there's some highlights coming. Apparently, there they are. Stage 12. This is when, so eventually the breakaway went.
And so much had happened before.
14 riders, a lot had happened just to set the scene, but Matthew Vanderpool jumped away from that group of 14 riders on the climb prior to this. He was alone for about 10 kilometers. And then Thibaut Pinot and Matteo Jorgensen, they closed the gap to him. This is just the start of the last climb, 32 kilometers to go. And shortly after that, the group from behind of another seven or eight riders would close up to them.
I was jumping up and down for Matteo Jorgensen here as an American. I mean, he's showing a physical depth, but also savviness beyond his years and tour experience to keep finding his way into these winning moves. And he was in there again today. But I think at this point, his competitors in the breakaway also know now, like, this guy is super strong and he's super smart and he's a force to be reckoned with. You know, we saw Vanderpool strike out early, which is a little surprising because he was going to be one of the strongest guys in that group, but clearly not confident he could stay with Pinot, Jorgensen, the stronger climbers, Benoot over the climb. So he went early. Ultimately, they caught him, dropped him. And then Izaguirre is the kind of the savvy, you'd almost call him veteran of this group, along with Pinot, and strikes out early and goes over the final climb of the day, the Cat 2.
And he had, Cofidis had two riders on that group. As we see the chasing group, Matteo Jorgensen taking the chasing group across the top of that climb with 35 seconds behind Izaguirre. They had two riders, and they had Guillaume Martin also. So they had a lot of good cards to play. And further back in the yellow jersey group, it was a big crash. But it's Tristan Tron from UNOX. He's had a couple of crashes this year in the Tour de France. In the first stage, he crashed and actually broke his elbow. So
that one was close to being a lot more than an elbow. He just missed that pole, and the bike just missed
cleaning
out all the guys behind him.
Yeah, luckily he was back up on the bike and he'd finished the stage. But that was a nasty crash from him. But further up the road again, 14K to go, Izaguirre would continue to extend his lead. We had a lot of attacks from behind. Matteo Jorgensen was very active in the group chasing behind. At this point, they're at about 30 or 40 seconds, and they were trying to close the gap. It's a bit disappointing that in this situation, Matteo Jorgensen was the only one who really had his bit between the teeth. He was kind of saying to these guys, we can still catch Izaguirre.
There is some dead weight in there, and obviously Graham Martin was a bit of that dead weight. Having that teammate of a guy up front just sucking your wheel repeatedly really demoralizes you. But they had the legs and the firepower back there to close them. But as we see time and time again, the lack of cohesiveness and the lack of commitment relative to what's going on in the front ultimately proves the difference of them not catching them.
And finally, with 3K to go, after many, many attempts, Jorgensen would get away with with the French guy from Total Energies. How do you say his name?
Bergadeau.
We'll get criticised for that, I'm sure, but I can't remember his name. And Berg something. And anyway, he finally got away, and Matteo Jorgensen deserved to get away. I felt really upset for him because he knew there was a stage enough for grabs, and they could have caught Azeguera, like we say, if the rest of the group was a bit more cooperative. So it's good that he finally got away, but unfortunately they were racing for second at that point.
They were racing for second, and up the road is Azeguera celebrating his second Tour de France stage win and the second win of this race for Cofidis, coming out of nowhere, breaking the drought. And
they hadn't won since 2000. This team hadn't won since 2008. And now they've won two in this year's Tour de France. Obviously, Victor Lafay won stage two earlier in the race and finishing. And those stages were in the Basque Country, where Jon Azeguera, today's stage winner, is actually from. He's from Bilbao. And it's his second win of his Tour de France career. He won in 2016 as well. And here's a group of the duo of Matteo Jorgensen coming across the line. He finished third for the French guy, again, that we can't remember his name. I can remember his name, I just don't know how to say it.
And then we have the sprint for 11th.
There's 10 guys up the road, and this is the sprint for 11th. I can understand why Lotto Destiny's sprinting here, because to go deeper into it, they're a relegated team at the moment, so UCI points are really important for them to get back into the World Tour, and there's UCI points available for 11th
Way
place
more
on
this
the line
year than there have been in years past.
And you can see here, Pogacar, bit of a smirk, bit of a smile. I think
he's having a good time.
He had nothing to gain by doing that. He just did it because he's a kid. He just races his bike, and he hasn't maybe developed the maturity of Vingegaard just to be like, look, mate, I'm just crossing the line here. The race is over. I'm safe. There's nothing to be gained by Pogacar doing
Why
that.
Not?
But he just does it.
It didn't cost him any. He thinks it didn't cost him anything anyway.
No, I wouldn't have.
I think there's some of that with those guys in that group too. Like, I just went through all of this. I suffered all of that. Like, yeah, like, my mom will like it if I'm like 12th on the results instead of 16th. Like, I'm gonna slide up there and push on the pedals a little bit. I know people are perplexed by guys sprint for placings that are minor, but still a Tour de France stage. And like, all those guys in that group, they went through a lot to get there today. That was not a sit on the wheel and coast into the finish and then sprint for 12th at the end. They were battling.
Oh, but I completely understand why Maxime Van Gils from Lotto Destiny sprinted.
Yeah.
But Pogacar, he just does it because he can. Look, there's nothing to be gained by it. He just does it because he can.
He'll like it. I mean, you saw Vingegaard right there on his wheel. It's that yellow on white combo that we saw the whole first half of stage two. It's that yellow shadow of the white jersey. Just like literally follows him anywhere. So maybe he's just another little acceleration. See if he can follow. And Vingegaard seems quite used to it.
Yeah.
At this point as well, and pretty relaxed in it. So
yeah, exactly. But
nothing taken.
It was an exciting stage, that's for sure. We said from the start it was a stage worth watching. And Matteo Jorgensen again, man, he's been so close. And he said after he was fourth in Puy de Dôme on Sunday, that was the third time he'd been fourth in the Tour de France. He was fourth twice the year prior. But he said after that stage, that one felt a little bit closer because he'd been up the road all day. But
he was more content in it also. Last year, he was quite frustrated in his fourth places. We heard him on the Puy de Dôme. He said, gave himself the best chance he could up against those climbers in that climb. He made his move. He was really proud of that. And I agree, it was his best chance, and he almost pulled it off. Today, he'll definitely be frustrated because he could feel and see that he had the legs. And In hindsight, he was a little bit of a marked man. His competitors have seen him in this race. They've seen him in the Tour riding so well. And that, I think, sort of worked against him. So, yeah, his only mistake was that he couldn't or didn't follow Azeguera when he went. But that could have, that's so easy to say, that could have quickly reshuffled everything and it would have played out differently. So
you know, I don't know if he could have followed Azeguera, honestly, on that climb. Azeguera, when he went, it was nobody could follow him from what I could see. But everybody knew, Jorgensen included, that was the place to launch your attack. But when he couldn't follow Azeguera, like the rest of the guys couldn't follow Azeguera, but they could catch Azeguera after that, because from there it was still 30 kilometers to the finish line, and there was a 25 second gap at the top of the climb. Jorgensen was there with a strong group of riders, and Jorgensen got, in my opinion, he got flicked by those guys. He was the only guy in there with any heart. He was the only guy in there with any honesty. And he was the only guy in there with any pride of what he was trying to do.
He's the only one really taking pulls.
Everybody else,
the rest of them are all doing the silly thing with the hand. Come on, guys,
trying to attack each other,
and then they'd still hit him.
Like, just work together, guys. Like we saw a couple of days ago when Chris Nayland's got caught with only a couple of kilometres to go, that was because it was a case of group behind that knew there was a stage victory up for grabs. You can't win the stage if you don't catch the guy in front. Don't try to flick each other before you catch him.
It's too many.
Catch the guy and then start flicking each other. So yeah. he got rolled there by a lack of cohesion in that group, and it was a real shame because he had the legs to win today. But yeah, the cards just didn't fall his way, unfortunately.
It'll come. I still believe Matteo. Well, it's not the last we'll see of him in a break.
Whether no, that's
it be
for
this
sure.
year or future years.
And the beauty of him is he's a strong rider. He's an honest rider. He's got pride. He knows what he wants to do. He knows what he wants to achieve. And he's a big, strong guy who can go uphill very fast as well, which is going to be very, very important for the coming stages, especially already looking at tomorrow's stage. It's a shorter stage tomorrow. It's from another pronunciation I've got to do, Châtillon-sur-Chalaronne to Grand Colombier. Short stage, shortest stage of the race so far, 137.8 kilometres. That's considerably less than 100 miles. But it's a relatively flat day all the way until the bottom of the last climb. There's a big lump in the middle there, but don't be deceived by that. That's a long, gradual climb just through a big valley road until they hit the bottom of Grand Colombier, which is a very famous climb. The Tour de France has been used many, many times before, and it's a 17.5K climb at 7%. So it's 17.5 kilometres. That's more than 10 miles, that climb. So it's going to be a big day for the showdown, GC showdown.
The Colombier is tricky because there's multiple Colombiers of the Tour de France. I think this one's only been used twice before.
Oh, really?
But there's
good info.
There's many versions of this mountain, this range, and multiple Colombiers that the Tour's seen. Easy to blend them together. But nonetheless, it's a brute of a climb, 17.5 kilometers. And it's, I think, the biggest single climb test that the riders will have faced up to this point. Not that massive accumulated climbing that we're going to see in the stages to come, but in terms of being on a mountain and climbing for, you know, the better part of an hour, it's the first time these guys will have done that. So it's a chance for the GC guys to make some moves, but I think there's also going to be some like patient prodding and wait and see and looking and seeing how each other are going, whether we're talking about the top two guys or whether we're talking about the guys beneath them fighting for that podium. And the climb tomorrow is going to be exciting in itself, but it's also really going to set the stage for what unfolds and the weekend stages, which are where the climbing really stacks up and gets accumulated.
It is a very unique stage. It's obviously the climb itself is a beast, but it's the first mountain stage that we've had in this year's Tour de France where it's just one mountain. All of the other stages have had, like you say, that accumulated climbing. They've done Col de Tourmalet, which is also a big Pyrenean climb, but that wasn't the final climb. It was only in the middle of the stage, and they had another climb to the finish. Tomorrow is essentially a flat stage, let's call it that, until the bottom of that climb. So it's a very different style of racing, less likely for a breakaway to be successful, I would think. There'll be some interest at the start. There always is. It's, you know, we're deep into the second week of the Tour de France now, so not many people are close to the top two guys outside of the top 10. Those guys are all free to go in the breakaway. If you're a Jumbo or a UAE, you're not worried about those guys. So there'll be some interest in the breakaway. I think it's important to note that it's Bastille Day tomorrow, which is the French national day. So pretty much every single Frenchman in the race will be trying to get in there, and then they'll all get in there and they'll all try to flick each other, but then they probably won't have any success. But it's certainly a stage of interest for all the French riders. So sure, for sure, it'll take some time for the breakaway to go, but ultimately, from my side at least, I think that it's going to be a head-to-head showdown in the GC battle between Vingegaard and Pogacar, no doubt. But then there's going to be a good race for the race for third place on the podium. Still very much alive. Jai Hindley has a couple-minute lead, but remembering that came from that breakaway, essentially all of that time early on in the Tour de France. So still hard to differentiate those guys, and it's going to be an interesting race to watch as well.
Yeah, there's a lot to play for still. It's only one climb, but there's still almost 8,000 feet of climbing tomorrow. And then for me, again, the headline is really how this sets up for the coming 2 days. Saturday, Sunday stages, I believe, have both over 4,000 meters of climbing, which is more than any single stage we've seen up to now. So when Jonas is being quite coy and saying how confident he is and that my stages are to come, my specialty is to come, we heard Sepp Kuss say the same thing. Like, these guys have been really, like, waiting for these moments, these big stages that are coming, and really at that tail end of tomorrow that sort of gets us in there. So we got,
you think they could be conservative tomorrow in that final climb with the weekend ahead?
I think, yeah, I anticipate that we won't see like the long peelers with 10K to go from the best climbers. I think we're going to see a bit of a standoff until the later stages, and then maybe we'll see some separation. But
especially if the breakaway is caught and they're racing for the stage, and then you're obviously talking about time bonus as well, and 10 seconds to cross the line first, 6 seconds to cross the line second. So there's a four, even if those two riders, Pogacar and Vingegaard, finish together and Pogacar wins the stage, it closes the gap again by 4 seconds. So will be in Vingegaard's interest to try to get at least a separation, even if it's a small separation. And
anything, every bit counts still.
And again, going back to what we've been saying for the last 12 days now, they haven't won a stage yet, Jumbo. And their best chance tomorrow is with Jonas Vingegaard. So it could still be it will be still an interesting GC race, I think. So we're looking forward to that, aren't we?
Let's do it. Stage 13 tomorrow. Bastille Day.
See you all tomorrow after stage 13.